Good morning and welcome to today's webinar hosted by the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond. Our discussion today focuses on Fifth District Emerging Risks, BSA, and liquidity. I'm Brad Straubinger with the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis, and I'll be your facilitator today. And allow me to introduce our presenters for today. From the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond, we have Elaine Yancey, Sue Werner, and Katie Bush. Now, on slide two, I'm going to actually cover our call logistics today. If you haven't already done so, click on the webinar link you received after registering. This option offers a few benefits. You can watch the slides as they are advanced. You can type questions to us. You can download the session material and an FAQ. And also, you can listen to the audio through your PC speakers. Please note the webinar performance is dependent upon your connection. So if at any time you're having problems, just pick up the phone and dial the toll-free number. Now, if you dial in via the phone, please note there may be a 30-second delay in the slide transitions, so you can click the materials button to download a copy of the presentation and follow along that way if you prefer. Also, as I talked about, the FAQ document under the materials button will help you if you have technical questions about the webinar platform today. Also, to ask questions today, you can submit them anytime by just clicking on the Ask Questions button in the webinar tool. Also, keep your mouse handy throughout the webinar as we'll be asking you to participate in some polling questions later on. One additional note here on slide three, I'm going to cover some legal information. The opinions expressed in the presentation are those of the author and do not necessarily indicate concurrence by the Board of Governors, the Federal Reserve Banks, or the members of their staffs. Although we strive to make the information in this publication as accurate as possible, it is made available for educational and informational purposes only. Accordingly, for purposes of determining compliance with any legal requirement, the statements and views expressed in this presentation do not constitute an interpretation of any law, rule, or regulation by the Board of Governors or by the officials or employees of the Federal Reserve System. With that out of the way, let me welcome our first presenter, Elaine. Take it away.
Thank you, Brad, and good morning and welcome, everyone. As Brad said, my name is Elaine Yancey, and I'm a managing examiner at the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond. And again, I'm joined today by Katie Bush, examiner, Sue Werner, risk specialist, also of the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond. The other presenters and I work in the community and regional division of our supervision, regulation, and credit department here at the Fed. This is the second Fifth District focused webinar. As a result of feedback we received from our state member banks last year, we created this semi-annual event to communicate with you about pertinent supervisory issues outside of the examination and inspection process. On slide five, I will discuss today's format, which includes a BSA discussion on FinCEN's final rules involving customer due diligence and beneficial ownership, followed by a Q&A, as well as a liquidity risk management discussion, also followed by a Q&A. On slide seven, as your first presenter, I'm fast-forwarding to that slide to tell you about the BSA discussion agenda. The agenda for the discussion includes an overview of FinCEN's final rules involving codifying existing customer due diligence practices and a new requirement involving written procedures to identify and verify the identities of beneficial owners of legal entity customers. Now, I just threw out a couple of terms that may be new to you, beneficial owner and legal entity customer. We will be covering these key definitions today, as well as the beneficial ownership and CDD rule requirements. We will also discuss the now explicit minimum CDD standard. We will offer supervisory expectations for complying with the new rules, and we will provide additional guidance and references related to the new rules, and then take your questions. So let's get started with a rule overview on slide nine. FinCEN has amended the Bank Secrecy Act regulation to explicitly require risk-based procedures for conducting ongoing customer due diligence. Conducting customer due diligence is something that you've been doing all along, but now, as a result of this rule, it's an explicit requirement. FinCEN has also amended the Bank Secrecy Act regulation to require financial institutions to establish and maintain written procedures designed to identify and verify the identities of beneficial owners of legal entity customers. Moving on to slide 10, the purpose of the rules. These rule changes are intended to increase transparency of U.S. legal entities through the collection of beneficial ownership information towards protecting the U.S. financial system. The rules are also intended to facilitate global implementation of international standards for CDD and beneficial ownership. The impetus of these rule changes is in part international-based. The rules help to satisfy transparency initiatives of several global groups, including but not limited to the Financial Action Task Force, the G8, and the U.S. Treasury. Other countries have similar rules, and this puts the U.S. in lockstep with these other countries. A final purpose of the rules is to help to support the enforcement of anti-money laundering, sanctions, tax regulations, and the combating of terrorism. Key definition, slide 11, legal entity customer. The official definition of legal entity customer is a corporation, limited liability company, or other entity that is created by the filing of a public document with the Secretary of State or similar office, a general partnership, and any similar entity formed under the laws of a foreign jurisdiction that opens an account. Legal entity examples that were embedded within the definition that I just read, corporations that are not publicly traded, limited liability companies, and general and limited partnerships. A legal entity customer would not include a natural person or sole proprietorships or unincorporated associations. This is because neither a sole proprietorship nor an unincorporated association is an entity with a legal existence separate from the associated individual or individuals. Key definition number two, beneficial owner, slide 12. A beneficial owner is each of the following. Each individual, if any, who directly or indirectly owns 25% or more of the equity interests of a legal entity customer, and this is also called the ownership prong, and a single individual with significant responsibility to control, manage, or direct a legal entity customer, including an executive officer or senior manager or any other individual who regularly performs similar functions, and this is called the control prong. With the control prong, the title of the individual is unimportant. It's the ability of that individual to control or manage or direct the legal entity. Note that the definition uses the term individual. This means natural persons who own or control legal entity customers. So on the previous two slides, we covered the definitions of beneficial owner and legal entity customer. So on slide 13, let's talk about what the financial institution has to do relative to these two terms. The beneficial ownership requirements include that by May 11, 2018, financial institutions must establish and maintain written procedures designed to identify and verify the individuals who directly or indirectly own 25% or more of the equity interest of a legal entity customer and identify and verify one individual with significant management responsibility. A legal entity, therefore, can have a maximum of five individuals, including the four owners at that 25% ownership threshold, as well as the one directing individual. The idea is that requiring legal entities seeking access to financial institutions to disclose identifying information of the beneficial of the natural persons who own or control them will make such entities more transparent and thus less attractive to criminals. Slide 14, beneficial ownership requirements. At a minimum, at the time a new account is open, the financial institution must collect information including the names of the beneficial owners and the single individual with controlling responsibility, also identifying information about each individual, including, again, the name, address, date of birth, and government identification number, and a certification of accuracy by the individual submitting the information. This certification requirement may be complied with by either using the optional certification form provided in Appendix A of the rule or by any other means that comply with the substantive requirements of this obligation. And now's a good time to let you know that you are financial institutions may rely on the information provided by the legal entity about beneficial owners as long as the financial institution has no actual knowledge of facts that would call such information into question. On slide 15 is a copy of FinCEN's optional certification form that you may use to comply with the certification requirement. Again, the requirement is that financial institutions must identify the beneficial owners of each legal entity at the time a new account is open, and they can do this by either using this optional certification form on slide 15 or by obtaining the same information along with the certification requirement. I think now's time for a polling question. Brad?
All right. Yes, we will go ahead and pose a question to the group, and you should be seeing it on your screen here, and we'll give folks some time to put their answer in. And the question is, do you intend to use FinCEN's optional certification form to collect beneficial ownership information? So we have a few choices there, yes, no, more than likely, or not sure. And I'll ask this question again, just so we have folks a few seconds more here to get their answer in. Do you intend to use FinCEN's optional certification form to collect beneficial ownership information? A, yes. B, no. C, more than likely. And D, not sure. Again, I'll give folks just a little more time to answer that question. And now I will go ahead and show the results. And the results are coming in right now, and it looks like not sure is 40%, so I'll give it back to you.
Thank you, Brad. Like I said, with this form, it's part of the rule. It's in Appendix A. You can use it if you like, or you can use a similar form or comply in another way. You just have to make sure you have to have that certification of accuracy by the individual opening the account. And at this time, I will turn the presentation to Katie Bush to discuss the CDD rule requirements.
Thanks, Elaine. So let's switch gears and talk about FinCEN's final rule for CDD. If you'll join me on slide 17. The CDD rule amends the AML program requirements for covered financial institutions to explicitly require covered institutions to implement and maintain risk-based procedures for conducting ongoing customer due diligence to include understanding the nature and purpose of customer relationships for the purpose of developing a customer risk profile and conducting ongoing monitoring of these relationships to identify and report suspicious transactions and on a risk basis to maintain and update customer information, including information regarding the beneficial owners. Understanding the nature and purpose of a customer relationship is used to help develop a customer risk profile. A customer risk profile is the information collected about a customer at account opening to create a baseline against which customer transactions are evaluated for suspicious activity reporting. This can include collecting information such as the purpose of the account, is this an operating account, a trust account, etc. The nature of the legal entity, you may consider assigning the NASIS code. The purpose of the legal entity business, for example, is this entity a wholesale entity or retail entity? Is the purpose of the entity to provide services or products? If so, what kind? Are they financial or accounting services? The idea behind codifying existing CDD practices, things that you are already doing, stated on this slide, is to promote consistency in implementing and enforcing CDD regulatory expectations across and within financial sectors, and advancing Treasury's broad strategy to enhance financial transparency of legal entities. So to this point, we've covered CDD and beneficial ownership rules. So now let's switch gears and talk about what we expect from you as your regulator related to compliance with these rules. If you'll join me on slide 19, this slide is intended to convey supervisory expectations for compliance to both of the rules. The caveat with the contents of this slide is that the FFIEC's BSA AML examination manual has not been revised to include examination procedures. Therefore, these expectations are preliminary. Now, the supervisory expectations that we've laid out for you here will be the expectations starting on May 11th, 2018. We've divided the expectations into four categories. One, we will expect that you implement and maintain written risk-based policies and procedures designed to meet the beneficial ownership and CDD requirements that Elaine and I have described on slides 14 and 16. We will expect that you will have conducted training and awareness throughout your organization to aid compliance with these final rules. Third, we will expect that you will follow the record retention requirements with respect to CDD and beneficial ownership. Fourth, we will expect that you, at some point, will incorporate risk-based transaction testing of CDD and beneficial ownership rule compliance into the scope of your independent review of your BSA compliance program. As I mentioned previously, the examination procedures within the FFIEC's BSA AML examination manual have not yet been revised to include these new final rules. It is critically important and a best practice that you consider any forthcoming information, whether it be the revised FFIEC BSA AML manual or another communication provided by the federal banking agencies or FinCEN on other supervisory regulatory expectations. If you'll turn with me to slide 20, we'd like to provide you with a few additional references and some guidance. First, the federal banking agencies will be releasing CDD and beneficial ownership examination procedures prior to May 11th, 2018, which will eventually be incorporated into the FFIEC BSA AML examination manual. Second, the industry has asked FinCEN to provide additional information, and FinCEN intends to do so. Third, FinCEN has released an FAQ document regarding customer due diligence for financial institutions on their website, and we've provided the link. Last, a link to the rules on the GPO's website has also been included. On slide 21, we'd like to summarize the BSA discussion for this webinar. FinCEN has amended the BSA regulation through final rules codifying existing customer due diligence practices and adopting the new beneficial ownership requirements. Effective compliance date is May 11, 2018. Supervisory expectations focus on written risk-based policies, procedures, and processes designed to comply with rules as well as training, testing, and record retention. Finally, exam procedures developed by the federal banking agencies are forthcoming and should be reviewed. With that, on slide 22, we'll be happy to take your questions. I'll also direct your attention to the series of slides at the end of the presentation that will provide you with some information about the Federal Reserve System in general and about the Richmond Fed supervisory function.
All right. Thank you very much, Katie. So we do have a few questions already coming in, and I do once again remind you, you can just click that Ask Questions button, and we will get those questions to our presenters. So the first one that came in was, what CIP information should a financial institution collect for beneficial owners?
Thank you, Brad. For beneficial owners, CIP information that you must collect includes the name, date of birth, address, and identification number of the beneficial owners. Once you do that, then you go into the verification process under CIP, which it can be documentary or non-documentary.
Okay, thank you for that. We did have another one come in. Do we need to validate CIP for beneficial owners?
So just an important distinction with this rule, you're not validating ownership. You are validating the identity of the beneficial owners. So that there's a distinction there. You're not making sure that what is provided to you at account opening is valid. Again, you're focusing on what's being provided to you at account opening in terms of who the beneficial are, and then you're verifying the identity of those individuals along with the controlling manager.
All right. Once again, you can ask a question just by clicking the button on your screen there, and we'll get those in. We'll also have another round of questions at the very end of the session, so if you're still thinking about your questions, you can wait till the end. But here's another one that came in. Are the new CDD requirements considered the fifth pillar, whereby if a bank is deemed to have insufficient CDD procedures on an examination, it would lead to a formal enforcement action?
So this term, fifth pillar, has been discussed a lot within the industry, and the federal banking agencies, at least the Federal Reserve, is not using that term. So if you have CDD issues within your BSA AML compliance program, we would evaluate them in the context of your BSA compliance level of compliance overall.
All right, thank you very much. Another question, is the beneficial ownership rule retroactive?
You will only need to obtain beneficial ownership information for accounts opened after the May 11, 2018 date. So, no, it is not retroactive.
Okay, and this one came in, again, by someone asking the question by just hitting their Ask Question button. We certify TINs at account openings for all accounts. Will we need to certify TINs for beneficial owners?
Yes, you will.
All right. Another question was that came in. How does the beneficial ownership rule apply to loan accounts?
The beneficial ownership rule applies to all accounts, including checking, savings, certificates of deposits, and loans. So it does apply to loans.
Okay. Here's another one that came in. How do we have non-governmental organizations, NGOs, charities, and religious organizations, such as churches, complete the certification of beneficial ownership?
NGOs, charities, and religious organizations are excluded from the ownership prong, so that you would just need to list that one controlling person who can direct that organization.
All right, we're going to give folks one last quick second to see if there's any more questions coming in, and it looks like as of right now, we are okay on questions, so I'm going to go ahead and move along to slide 23 and hand it off to Sue Werner.
Okay. Good morning. We will move to slide 24 to get started. I have provided a quote written 8 years ago in the opening paragraph of SR Letter 10-6, the Interagency Guidance on Funding and Liquidity Risk Management. Even though written then, it expresses regulators' concerns today related to liquidity. We are seeing that liquidity risk management is in need of improvement at some institutions due to insufficient holdings of liquid assets, evidence that risky or illiquid assets are being funded with potentially volatile short-term liabilities, and that there is a lack of meaningful cash flow projections and contingency funding plans for this level of risk. Moving to slide 25, today I will briefly cover key financial indicators signaling increasing liquidity risk, the concept of risk layering or cross-risk, a way to view your bank's potentially volatile funding sources. We'll also review trends in regulatory liquidity concerns over the last 2 years and provide some preliminary insights from a horizontal review of moderate and high liquidity risk bank examination work papers in order to share some ideas that may be helpful to you before your next examination, particularly if your bank exhibits high or increasing liquidity risk. Moving on to slide 26, a primary financial indicator for liquidity risk, as stated in SR 10-6 guidance, is when there are insufficient holdings of liquid assets. In the top right graph, the solid lines reflecting the holdings of interest-bearing bank balances, Fed funds sold, and unencumbered securities shows liquid assets. What you will notice is that for the 2 years after the guidance was issued in 2010, liquid assets, as defined in this manner, continued to increase. But since 2012, there has been a declining trend. Liquid assets are not at 2008 levels, but they are back to 2010 levels with a declining trend. During the same five-year period, reflected by the dotted lines, loans have seen steep growth and only recently beginning to level off. The bottom left graph shows something that is different to the lead-up period before the last recession, which adds a layer of uncertainty to this definition of liquid assets. There was an increase in the holding of municipal bonds in the 4 years after the recession. This is important because unencumbered municipals may be somewhat more liquid than, say, a U.S. Treasury or agencies due to their longer durations and therefore higher credit and interest rate risk. It is important that if you hold something other than highly liquid securities as your bank's liquid assets, that you have tested scenarios where they are not as liquid as they are potentially today, such as in a period of rapidly rising interest rates. We will now have a polling question.
All right. Thank you very much, Sue. And this is an easy one here for the folks watching over the webinar. And the question is on your screen now, or should be, do you have an asset liquidity ratio limit similar to what has been described in this presentation? So easy answers here, yes, no, or not sure. And I'll read it one more time for the folks who might be on a little bit of a lag. Do you have an asset liquidity ratio limit similar to what has been described in this presentation? Yes, no, or not sure. And let's take a look at those results now.
Another trend we are watching is the growth in traditionally riskier assets. As reflected in the top chart, CRE lending has been steadily increasing since 2011. CRE concentrations have been trending up since about 2013 in our district. Okay, we see the results now. I'll stop. Looks like that a lot of institutions have a asset liquidity ratio similar to the way we described it, but there is some uncertainty. So we will take that as relatively good news, and certainly there probably is there individuals on the call that wouldn't really know they've been if they're here for maybe the BSA call. So as I said. CRE lending has been increasing, and that's reflected in that top graph. Now, where risk is harder to pinpoint related to credit risk is where data is not collected nationally. And that's one of our concerns is related to underwriting standards and how they may have changed. In our conversations with many of you, it has become clear that competition for loans during this low-rate environment has changed some of your lending standards. Hearing this, we undertook a small review across examination work papers in 2016 and again in 2017 to look at underwriting standards. Our results are in the chart on the bottom right. Arguably, our samples were limited and therefore may not be indicative of what is going on district-wide or at your institution. But our belief is that underwriting is potentially riskier today than directly following the recession, and that creates some uncertainty. For instance, how will the increasing level of non-recourse or limited recourse lending play out? On the next slide, slide 28, we've provided a chart that shows the level of non-core funding as seen in the solid lines. Actually, non-core funding has been somewhat stable since about 2012. Of course, there are banks in our district with non-core funding growth and some with growing funding concentrations. But there are also differences in some funding today. For one, listing deposits, which are not actually included in this non-core number, may be higher and potentially volatile, and some more traditionally core funding may demonstrate higher volatility than before. To show that, the dotted lines on this chart show the growth or surge in MMDAs beginning around 2009. And leveling off in 2013.
concerns with this flight out of longer-term CDs to non-maturity products has been written about over the last few years. And in fact, there is an article in our Community Banking Connections publications from 2015. Banks that have experienced this growth should consider how to test the potential volatility of these deposits in cash flow projections. In the next slide, number 29, we are showing the concept of risk layering, where multiple different risks add up and could compound the level of total risk when two or more or all of these are prevalent for an individual bank. We fully expect that risk layering, where evident at an institution, be adequately addressed within a bank's strategic plan and feed into contingency funding plans and capital planning processes. Risk layering is something that we became concerned about when the Office of the Inspector General reviewed failed banks in the last financial crisis. They found that any one of the factors listed on this slide were not as concerning as the combination of these factors, which you can't see, but they're basically robust growth objectives, rapid loan growth leading to exceeding the bank's risk management capabilities, asset concentrations tied to CRE or construction, insufficient capital to cushion losses, and risky funding strategies. Any one of those were not as risky as the combination of any or all of them. While we believe that risk layering conditions are becoming evident at some banks, overall conditions look better than before the last recession. However, there is uncertainty associated with some of the differences in conditions that we've discussed. Okay, looks like we're caught up. We're going to move to slide 31. On slide 31, we have provided a scatter plot to show a view of risk layering specific to the 5th District. Each dot on the slide is a financial institution in the district. We have plotted the level of non-owner-occupied CRE concentrations and liquid assets, as we defined it earlier. This is the all-in non-owner-occupied that includes construction and land development for which there is a 300% capital threshold for regulatory scrutiny of risk management practices. Banks in the bottom right quadrant of this scatter plot demonstrate high credit risk and high liquidity risk related to those two factors. Those institutions clustered near the boundary of this quadrant also have some level of risk layering. While some banks may have operated in conditions reflected in the lower right quadrant during the prior recession, we believe that the recipe for success changes over time and under different conditions. On slide 32, we have provided a final view of risk layering. The scatter plot in this slide, slide 32, shows non-owner-occupied CRE concentration levels. But this time, we have plotted the institution's potentially volatile funding sources. Therefore, the banks in the top right quadrant of this plot reflect the highest risk within the district because they have higher CRE concentrations and higher use of potentially volatile funding sources. There are more dots or institutions in the higher risk quadrant than in the prior slide's riskier quadrant, but some of these are the same banks. I think I'm going to skip the polling questions that we had prepared because we seem to be having some technical difficulties with them. So moving on to slide 33, I've used the term potentially volatile funding sources in the last slide. Obviously, to create the last scatter plot, we had to develop a definition of funding sources to include in this concept because that term is not really a call report number or calculation, and it's not really well-defined in SR letter 10-6. But in general, we see potentially volatile funding as funding that may disappear under heavy pricing competition, deteriorating credit or market risk conditions, or any otherwise adverse scenarios. It is funding that may not act the same way at every bank or perform as it did during the last recession. primarily wholesale funding sources such as brokered deposits, high-rate deposits, and borrowings. But for some banks, it could also include call report-defined core deposits if there is potential volatility in those deposits. We expect banks to know what makes up their potentially volatile funding so that those sources can be properly stress-tested in cash flow projections. Let's move on to slide 34, if we can. And we're going to discuss trends from recent regulatory events. The Federal Reserve issues all banks a risk management rating. That rating is a combined view of six risks: credit, liquidity, market, operational, legal, and compliance. Over the past 2 years, 45% of Fifth District state member banks have shown signs of increasing liquidity risk. That's pretty high, and right up there with the percentage of banks reflecting signs of increasing credit risk, indicating again the potential for risk layering. The problem that we are seeing is that liquidity risk management is not keeping up with the increasing risk. We know this because of the number of findings that we have issued related to liquidity risk management in the last 2 years. The pie chart shows that the primary theme, and of course you can't see it, but the primary theme is ineffective cash flow modeling and stress testing scenarios within the contingency funding plans. We recently completed a small horizontal review of some moderate, high, or increasing risk liquidity work papers completed by examiners over the last 2 years. We found that cash flow base case modeling is not always where we expected it to be for higher risk banks. Guidance requires cash flow projections be commensurate with complexity. For banks with higher complexity and higher risk, we expect first that cash flows are tailored at a level which allows for inputs and assumptions that can reflect past trend analysis or that show well-supported, up-to-date projections. That is, higher-risk banks should not have cash flow models where static budget data is input that may be overly optimistic. Also, it's hard to imagine that an accurate, well-defined model isn't occasionally back-tested to improve results over time. Back-testing is really just a part of effective modeling. We also found that scenario stress testing had room for improvement, and we are at slide 36. Guidance requires scenario stress testing of discrete and cumulative cash flow mismatches over various time horizons, and these are both plural, cash flow mismatches and time horizons. Enhanced or best practice stress test scenarios change over time to help inform action plans relevant to new risk considerations. A variety of relevant combinations of high probability, low risk scenarios and low probability, high risk scenarios should be considered for testing. If risk layering is heightened at an institution, then stress testing should incorporate risk layering considerations. For instance, if your institution has CRE loans securing your FHLB funding lines that are counted on for contingent funding, then testing should include a scenario where those CRE loans securing the lines undergo rapid deterioration. Not only should you ensure that the funding that can be replaced with something else, but plans and procedures should be tested to ensure the situation can be handled quickly to either replace those loans or do something different. For higher risk liquidity banks or those using brokered funding, a falling below the well-capitalized scenario should be tested, even though it may be unlikely based on your capital position. Finally, scenario testing should be followed by some evidence, such as updates to the contingency funding plan, new procedures on how to handle certain aspects of the plan, or active discussions at ALCO that reflect scenario stress testing results were used to make liquidity risk management decisions. On slide 37, we talk about the last step of the two processes just discussed, cash flow modeling and scenario stress testing. And that is that risk tolerance levels, including a liquid asset buffer as required by SR 10-6, should be set following that information. The idea is that an institution's liquid asset limit should be the result of constantly or routinely updated information gained from effective cash flow modeling of the institution's current risk level and projections under relevant and varied scenario stress tests. This buffer should probably change on occasion as risks or risk layering increases. That is, if your institution's first line of defense, which is liquid or highly liquid assets, does not appear to provide much of a buffer for realistic, current, and compounding stress scenarios, then the liquid asset or highly liquid asset buffer and your board's risk limit tolerance may be set too low. When assessing or adjusting risk tolerance levels, keep in mind that action planning for adverse situations and early warning triggers should stay aligned to keep the institution operating within a safe zone below the limits. In closing, we are seeing increasing liquidity risk trends system and district-wide at some banks more than but at some banks more than others. If your institution has been assessed as having high inherent liquidity risk or is seen to have an increasing liquidity risk trend due to risk layering, then our expectation is that your risk management practices are already at an enhanced level to monitor and manage that risk. SR Letter 10-6, the Commercial Bank Exam Manual, and the Trading and Capital Markets Activity Manual provide clear expectations on the tools and processes discussed today. And they also take a look, take a look at those expectations on a routine basis to make sure that you are following that guidance. The parting message for today is that the contingency funding plan, much like a bank's disaster recovery plan or its capital plan, should be routinely updated to be relevant for the bank's current risk-taking strategies. So, I believe we are should be on page 39, or slide 39, and we will take questions if we have some coming in.
Yes, we do, and once again, really want to apologize for the technical issues we're having. We have tried everything to kind of help along, but great job by our presenters today to keep going. There is a PDF presentation in your materials button, so hopefully you've been following along that way or can follow along that way after the session. So we did have questions come in during this presentation, and so we appreciate that. And the first one we asked, or what's asked, was what is an appropriate asset liquidity ratio for community banks, or is there a minimum liquid asset ratio?
Okay. We get asked this question a lot, and I would refer you back to slide 37, where I stated that the level of liquid assets should be based on the intel that you routinely get from effective cash flow monitoring and stress testing of that base case with relevant and varied institution-specific and business-driven adverse conditions. This intel should be discussed after completion of the testing with the Board of Directors to align their risk appetite to the results. Our expectation is that liquid assets are an important source of both primary, or your operating liquidity, and secondary, or contingent liquidity funding. So, no, there really isn't a minimum. but certainly the more risk that the institute that an institution is taking, and the higher level of potentially volatile funding sources should drive institutions to consider holding a higher liquid asset buffer.
All right, we did have another question come in. How many stress scenarios should banks run? Should stress events be layered?
Well, they certainly should be layered, but stress events are, again, going to be determined based on the risk level and specific to the institution. We usually see that institutions run stress scenarios of their base case modeling anywhere from 2 to 4 times a year. What we often, though, see is that they don't vary the types of tests that are run as often as would be beneficial to them. So if you run the same scenario over time, it's not necessarily going to give you new information that will help you to adjust either risk tolerances or procedures, action planning, things of that nature that will really keep your contingency funding plan up to date for what is going on and the risks that the bank is taking. So we really would, you know, advise banks to at least annually hold a discussion, talk about the different risks, the different risk layers, and then to create scenarios that are relevant for that coming year, and then to run those scenarios. And again, they should be high probability, lower risk, and then there should also be some combinations of lower probability from occurring, but which could present higher risk liquidity scenarios.
Okay, we had another question come in. How far out should we be projecting our cash flows?
That's a good question. For most institutions, we expect that they go out on a weekly basis through the first month, and then maybe on a monthly basis, and through you know, some number of quarters after that. For planning purposes, it's really important that the inputs and the assumptions going on are reviewed so that you're getting more accurate data versus trying to, you know, estimate in future periods where you don't have as accurate of information. So we would kind of recommend looking at week by week and month by month. Once you start to get out, you know, past 6 months or 9 months, it becomes, of course, less useful. But really what we would say related to modeling cash flows is that each line item, particularly for banks with more complex balance sheets, should be reviewed more carefully on an ongoing basis and back-tested to see if your assumptions and projections and the manner in which you do them are accurate, you know, as accurate as they can be.
Okay, we had another one that came in, and once again, we thank everybody for their patience, and a lot of you have stayed on with us throughout the technical difficulties and continue to ask questions. It was very helpful for us. Appreciate that. Why do regulators continue to worry about the amount of brokered deposits for banks that are well capitalized and demonstrated low asset quality issues during that last crisis?
Well, essentially, we continue to see brokered deposits as volatile funding that are rate sensitive and may disappear under heavy pricing competition, deteriorating credit or market risk conditions, or any otherwise adverse scenarios. Even though rates paid on brokered deposits have not always been higher than those paid for in local market areas, brokered deposit customers are generally focused on obtaining the highest insured rate available. They have easy access to and are frequently well informed about alternative markets and investments, and good rates today may not last. So we are certainly not opposed to institutions using broker deposits as part of their funding strategy. We recommend a diversified approach, and that also the level of brokered deposits is taken into account, as well as overall wholesale funding, including borrowings and potentially listing deposits and other deposits that we noted under the potentially volatile funding sources.
Okay, another question came in. Do the regulators feel more comfortable with secured borrowings at the FHLB?
It's not our role to distinguish one wholesale funding source over another. That certainly is a decision for the institution and their board to make. Obviously, FHLB funding reflects different risks that must be managed appropriately as well. So FHLB secured funding over time, you know, is dependent on the collateral that is pledged. And we have seen that in some cases there is a lot of CRE or C&I loans that are being pledged, which obviously don't get as high of a return. But what we need to see that institutions are doing is that where higher or riskier loans are securing that funding, that they are taking into account that the loss or impairment of access to those funds secured by assets must be really understood and tested. So there needs to be like contingency type of planning if the loans that are securing the funding were to deteriorate.
Okay, and we had another one for that came in for this part of the session. Where can I find a good example of a base case cash flow?
The Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve System have a trading and capital markets activity manual, and in section 3005.5, the appendix has really good information and example of cash flow. Also, the FDIC produced this summer, the summer 2017 issue of Supervisory Insights features two articles of interest. One is the Community Bank Liquidity Risk Trends and Observations from Recent Examinations. So it was a article similar to what we discussed today. And it also has an example in there as well that can be used.
Okay, and then we had some questions come in during the earlier portion of the presentation, so we'll go back to those now. Does the BO rule apply to loan renewals or extensions?
Thank you, Brad. The answer to that question is, according to FinCEN, yes, as of right now. At this time, you should treat CD rollovers and loan renewals as new accounts. However, FinCEN is issuing additional guidance, as we alluded to earlier, as Katie mentioned, that where this may be a change. So that's the answer to that question.
Okay, another one that came in for the earlier portion. If there is just a control prong, do we still have to get the certification form?
There is still a certification requirement, even if you're just, you just have one controlling individual that is required to be identified. So, yes.
All right, and our last question for the session is, can FIs use different versions of the BO from within their institution?
That is a business decision. You know, they certainly can. But, you know, just something to think about in terms of consistency across an organization.
Okay, and at this point we are out of questions, and I just wanted to see if our presenters had any last closing thoughts.
I was just going to reiterate, Brad, that the beneficial ownership and CDD rules are FinCEN rules, and if you have additional questions, a best practice would be to reach out to FinCEN for any of the questions that we haven't answered, or if you'd like to talk about the rule, you're certainly welcome to contact us here at the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond.
And I would just say that if there are any questions about this presentation or liquidity at your institution, reach out to your relationship team that works with you at the Federal Reserve, or obviously if you're not working with us, a relationship team at your primary federal regulator to discuss your practices and to prepare for increasing liquidity risk.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Once again, I do want to apologize for the technical issues. We tried diligently to fix them here, but we appreciate you staying on the line and appreciate our presenters for just going along with the presentation. Once again, you can get the PDF in the materials portion, and there will be a recording as well. And with that, I'll officially bring the session to a close. We thank you for joining us, and have a great rest of your day.